गुड आफ्टरनून, वेलकम टू बेसिक इलेक्ट्रिकल इंजीनियरिंग यूनिट 4 इलेक्ट्रिकल मशीन्स लेक्चर 25 थ्री फेज इंडक्शन मोटर। एंड टुडेज टॉपिक इज थ्री फेज इंडक्शन मोटर लॉसेस एफिशिएंसी स्पीड कंट्रोल ऑफ थ्री फेज इंडक्शन मोटर एंड स्टार्टिंग मेथड्स ऑफ थ्री फेज इंडक्शन मोटर। एज वी हैव डिस्कस्ड, induction motor is also known as a asynchronous motor, which is a commonly used AC electric motor. Induction motor are referred to as asynchronous motors because they operate at speed less than synchronous speed. In an induction motor, electrical current in rotor needed to produce the torque is obtained by via electromagnetic induction process from the rotating magnetic field of the stator winding. The rotor of an induction motor can be squirrel cage rotor or slip ring or wound rotor type. This is a basic practical induction motor. Now there are basically two types of induction motors, as we have seen earlier. The types of induction motors depends on the input supply. They are single phase and three phase induction motors, and single phase induction motors are not self starting motors, and three phase induction motors are self starting. And we have also discussed the reason for this in the previous lecture. Now, single phase induction motors are further classified as split phase induction motor, capacitor start induction motor, capacitor start capacitor run induction motor, shaded pole type induction motor. And three phase induction motors are classified as squirrel cage induction motor and slip ring induction motor. Now, losses and efficiency, we have to look at the power flow diagram. A power flow diagram explains the input given to the motor, the losses occurring, and the output of the motor. So, efficiency is generally given by output power by input power. PM is the output power, and PI is the input power. Percentage, if you are taking it, is into 100. This is the power flow diagram. You can see stator, this is the stator block, this is the rotor block, and useful mechanical power. From the rotor shaft that you have, you'll get the useful mechanical power, which is coupled to the load. Now there is some input power PI that is given. This is called PI or P1, and this is the power P2. And in stator you have stator losses, that is P2. What is the power output of stator is equal to P1 power input minus the stator losses. This is P1 minus stator losses. Similarly, if P3 is the output of the rotor, now P3 is equal to P2 input to the rotor minus rotor copper loss. There are copper losses that are present in rotor, they are rotor copper losses. And there are some other losses like friction and windage losses. And the PM is a mechanical output, useful mechanical output, which is the difference of P3 minus friction and windage losses. Now stator input, from stator input we'll get stator output. And state for stator we are giving input and the output is obtained, and there are I square R losses in the stator and core losses in the stator, and you will get the stator output, that is air gap power, which is given to the rotor. So there are I square R losses in the rotor and total mechanical power developed, and this total mechanical power developed has rotor core loss, friction losses, windage losses, stray losses, and after this you will get the useful power output obtained at the rotor shaft. Losses in stator. The power flow is given by P is equal to root 3 VLIL cos phi. That is 3 line voltage is converted into phase. V phase voltage, I phase voltage into cos phi, where cos phi is the input power factor. Now losses in stator are I square R losses in the stator windings. It is also known as stator copper loss. Stator copper loss. SCL. Stator copper loss. P is the power stator copper loss is equal to, in three phase, 3 into I square into R. Power loss is given as I square R. V into I, V is equal to I into R, therefore I square into R. Because there are three phases, 3 times of I square R. Hysteresis and eddy current losses in the stator core. These are known as the stator core losses. So they are given by stator hysteresis plus eddy current losses. Now these two combinedly are subtracted from the input given power. So output of stator POS, power output of stator is equal to power input of stator minus stator copper loss minus hysteresis and eddy current losses. These are copper losses and these are core losses, nothing but iron losses. So this output of power of the stator is transferred to the rotor of the machine across the air gap between the stator and the rotor. It is called as the air gap power, PG, of the machine. Now thus the power output of the stator is air gap power is equal to input to the rotor. PG is equal to IPIR, input to power input to rotor. POS is the power output from the stator, which is PI minus PSCL minus PH plus E, that we have seen last slide. The losses in rotor are as follows. In the rotor also you have rotor copper losses 3 times of I2 square R2, and there are also hysteresis and eddy current losses. So they are rotor core losses as in stator. So PR into H plus E, though input is PIR, therefore output will be. Now there are friction and windage losses. If the rotor copper losses are subtracted from the rotor input, PG, rotor input is PIR minus rotor copper losses PRC, or PIR is nothing but air gap power, PG. So the mechanical power developed is equal to PIR minus PRC, or it is PG minus what is PRC, it is 3 times of I2 square R2, we have seen it. So mechanical power developed is equal to rotor input minus rotor copper losses. The total power output of the motor is given by P naught is equal to power developed, mechanical power developed minus friction and miscellaneous, stray losses, friction and windage losses, etc. So P output is the shaft power of the useful power out of the rotor of the machine. Now efficiency of a three phase induction motor. Efficiency is defined as the ratio of output to the input, and efficiency is equal to output by input, eta. Rotor efficiency of the three phase induction motor is rotor output by rotor input, that is equal to Pm by P2. And three phase induction motor efficiency is equal to power developed at shaft by electrical power input to the motor. Now speed control methods. A three phase induction motor is basically a constant speed motor, so it's somewhat difficult to control its speed. The speed control of induction motor is done at the cost of decrease in efficiency and low power factor. The basic formulas for speed and torque of a three phase induction motor from equivalent circuit are given like this. Ns is equal to 120 F by P. This is the synchronous speed, which is the speed of the rotating magnetic field or the field set up by the stator winding of the three phase induction motor. And the speed of the induction motor N is given as Ns into 1 minus S, where S is the slip. And torque is given as 3 by 2 pi n into s e2 square r2 by r2 square plus s into x2 square whole square. And when the rotor is at standstill, s is 1. So the equation becomes 3 by 2 pi n s into e2 square r2 by r2 square plus x2 square. These are the expressions for speed and torque. In order to understand speed control, you have to know this, the expressions or the formula for speed and the torque of a three-phase induction motor. The speed of induction motor is changed both from stator and rotor side. Speed control of three phase induction motor from stator side are classified as V by F control or frequency control, changing the number of stator poles, controlling the supply voltage. You can control the speed of the three phase induction motor by adding a rheostat in the stator circuit. You can control the speed of the induction motor. Now speed of the three phase induction motor from rotor side, you can control the speed of induction motor either from the stator side or from the rotor side. So these were the methods for stator side, and now we are discussing the rotor side. The adding external resistance on rotor side, or cascade control method, or injecting slip frequency EMF into the V by F control or frequency control. This is the most popular method of controlling the speed of induction motor. If the supply frequency is reduced, keeping the rated voltage, the air gap flux will tend to saturate. This will cause excessive stator current and distortion of the stator flux wave. Therefore, stator voltage should be reduced in proportional to the frequency, so as to maintain the air gap flux constant. The magnitude of stator flux is proportional to the ratio of stator voltage and the frequency. Hence, if the ratio of voltage to frequency is kept constant, flux remains constant. Therefore, speed is controlled. By keeping V by F control is constant, that developed torque remains approximately constant. This method gives higher runtime efficiency. Therefore, majority of AC speed drives employ constant V by F method for speed control. Along with wide range of speed control, this method also offers a soft start capability. Now, changing the number of stator poles. From the equation of synchronous speed, ns is equal to 120 f by p, it can be seen that the synchronous speed can be changed by changing the number of stator poles. Ns is equal to 120 f by p, p is the number of poles. By changing p, you can change the speed ns. This method is generally used for squirrel cage induction motors, as squirrel cage rotor adapts itself for any number of stator poles. Change in stator pole is achieved by two or more independent stator winding for different number of poles. If the number of poles is 4, synchronous speed is 1500 rpm. If the number of poles is made 6, the speed obtained is 1000 rpm. That's how you can maintain the speed of a induction motor. Now, control supply voltage method. From the torque equation, T is proportional to S into E2 square, where E2 is the rotor induced EMF, but E2 is proportional to voltage V. Therefore, T is proportional to S into V2 square, we can say, which means if the supply voltage is decreased, torque developed decreases. Hence, for providing the same load torque, the slip increases with a decrease in voltage, and consequently speed decreases. This method is easiest and cheapest, still rarely used because large change in supply voltage is required for relatively small change in the speed. Large change in supply voltage will result in large change in flux density. Hence, this will disturb the magnetic conditions of the motor. Therefore, it is, although it's easiest and cheapest, it is rarely used method. Now, adding rheostat in the stator circuit. In this method of speed control of three-phase induction motor, rheostat is added in the stator circuit. Due to this, voltage gets dropped. If resistance is increased, voltage automatically decreases. In case of three-phase induction motor, as we have seen in the previous slide, T is proportional to V2 square. Torque, if we decrease the supply voltage, torque will also decrease. But for supplying the same load, torque must remain same. So if the slip increases, motor will run red. Now, adding external resistance on the rotor side. Now, in this method of speed control three-phase induction motor, from the rotor side, external resistance can be added on the rotor side. The equation of torque is T is equal to S into E2 square R2 by R2 square plus S into X2 square. In low slip region, S2 square is very small compared to R2, so it can be neglected. Also, E2 is constant, so T is proportional to S by R2. Now, if we increase rotor resistance R2, torque decreases. But to supply the same load torque must remain constant. So we increase slip, which will further result in the decrease in the rotor speed. Thus, by adding additional resistance in the rotor circuit, we can decrease the speed of the induction motor or control the speed of the induction motor. This method is used where the speed above the normal speed is not possible. Only speed above the below the normal speed is possible by using this method. Cascade control method. In this method of speed control three-phase induction motor, two induction motors are connected on common shaft and hence called as cascade motor. One motor is called main motor, other one is called as the auxiliary motor. The supply is given to the stator of the main motor while the auxiliary motor is derived at slip frequency from the slip ring of the main motor. In this method, four different speeds can be obtained. They are like 120 f by p1, 120 f by p2, 120 f by p1 plus p2, and 120 f by p1 minus p2. Now, injecting slip frequency EMF into the rotor side. When the speed control of three-phase induction motor is done by adding resistance in the rotor circuit, some part of power called slip power is lost. Therefore, efficiency of motor is reduced by this speed control. The slip power loss can be recovered and supplied back to improve the overall efficiency of the induction motor. This scheme of recovering the power is called as slip power recovery scheme, and this is done by connecting an external source of EMF of slip frequency to the rotor circuit. the injected EMF can either oppose the rotor or it can aid the rotor. So if it opposes, then speed will decrease. If injected EMF aids, then the rotor then the EMF decreases and speed increases. Therefore, injecting induced EMF in the rotor circuit, the speed can be easily controlled. Now, starting methods. That was all about the speed control of induction motor, three-phase induction motor. Now, coming to the starting method, why do we need a starter? The three-phase induction motor behaves like an electrical transformer with short-circuited secondary winding, which I have also told you in the previous class. Why do we need this starting methods or starters? At the time of starting, the rotor is stationary and back EMF due to rotation is not developed yet. Hence, motor draws high current, starting current. We use starters in order to limit the high starting current. This is a statement that you have to remember. Starter is used to limit the high starting current. Now, the types of three-phase induction motor starters are: for slip ring induction motor, we'll go for rotor rheostat starter. For squirrel cage induction motor, we'll use DOL starter, primary resistance starter, auto transformer starter, star delta starter, and for other starters, we'll use soft starters, which is not a part of your syllabus. We'll discuss these different types of starters, starting from DOL. We'll start with DOL, star delta, primary resistance, auto transformer, then we'll end up with rotor rheostat starter. Now, DOL, direct online starter. It is a simple and cheap starter for three-phase induction motor. The contacts close against spring action. This method is normally limited to small cage induction motors. A DOL starter consists of coil operated contactor, which can be controlled by start and stop push buttons. This is start push button and this is a stop or off put button. And when the start push button is pressed, this will press all these three. The contact gets energized and it closes all the three phases of the motor. This will get closed. And motor, three phases of the motor to supply phases at the time. The stop button, push button de-energizes the contactor, disconnects all the three phases to stop the motor. Now, when it is in running condition, then is this off button is pressed so that these all get de-energized. This is DOL starter. Now, star delta starter. A three-phase motor will give three times the power output when the stator winding are connected in delta than if connected in star. If they are connected in delta, the motor will give three times power. No, but we'll take 1/3 of the current from the supply when connected in star than when connected in delta. Therefore, it's better to connect in star than connecting in delta because it only takes 1/3 current during starting. So first, when starting the motor, we'll connect the stator winding such that they are connected as star. Then we'll connect them as delta. A two position switch, manual or automatic, is provided through a timing relay. Starting in star reduces the starting current. When the motor has accelerated up to speed and current is reduced to its normal value, starter is moved to run position with winding connected in delta, as I told you. Now, this is a stator and this is a rotor, squirrel cage rotor. This is a stator. Now, this is a three-phase supply. First, we'll connect this. This is star. We'll connect this as a star first. This stator winding are connected in star if you connect to these three, and when it starts running, we'll connect it to this so that it is connected in delta. So this is run delta connection and this is start star connection. Auto transformer starting. These auto transformers are also known as auto starters. They can be used for both star or delta connected squirrel cage motors, operated by two position switch, manual or automatic, using timer to change over from start to run position. In starting position, supply is connected to stator winding through an auto transformer, which reduces applied voltage to 50, 60 or 70% of normal value. Reduced voltage reduces current in the motor winding. At the time of start, less voltage is applied to motor by a three-pole double throw switch, TPDT. After the motor has accelerated to full load speed, the operating handle is moved to run position. Now, this is auto transformer starter. This is a handle. Now we'll first we'll connect this supply through this auto transformer. Now these are closed, and when the motor picks up its speed, now this auto transformer is disconnected and these are back connected to this. This is auto transformer starter. Using primary resistors. The purpose of primary resistors is to drop some voltage and apply a reduced voltage to stator. If voltage is reduced, current reduces. Let the starting voltage is reduced by 50%, then according to Ohm's law, starting current will also be reduced by the same percentage. From the torque equation of three-phase induction motor, starting torque is approximately proportional to the square of the applied voltage. That means if the voltage applied is 50% of rated value, starting torque will only be 25% of its normal voltage value. This method is generally used for smooth starting of small induction motors. You can see this. We'll use some resistors so that the voltage reduces, the applied voltage reduces, as a result current through them also reduces. Rotor rheostat starter. To start a slip ring induction motor, a three-phase rheostat is connected in series with the rotor circuit. Three-phase rheostat. Rheostat is a variable resistor, is connected in the rotor circuit. This is known as rheostat starter. This is made of three separate variable resistors joined together by means of a three-phase armed handle, which forms the star point. By moving the handle, equal resistance in each phase can be introduced. At start, whole of the rheostat resistance is inserted in the rotor circuit and the rotor current is reduced correspondingly. It reduces the current drawn by the motor at the starting. You can see this. This is the rotor. To this, using brushes, a rheostat is connected, a starting rheostat and speed controller. By this, the starting current is reduced. So this is the end of lecture 25, Basic Electrical Engineering, Unit 4. And this is also the end of the Unit 4, Electrical Machines. Thank you.